Thank you very much, Claire. Happy to give a talk before this audience, and I'm really curious what you think of it. It connects also nicely to you know, talks of this morning, where El Niño was already mentioned twice. And in this talk, we're really going to show something about new predictions of El Niño. Now, for those in the audience, you know, maybe more computer scientists, I'm going to explain a bit about El Niño because it motivates further work which we do with machine learning. And then I will show you results using machine learning for ENSO prediction and try to give a bit of an overview what has been done and what is currently going on. So yeah, El Niño is quite an anomaly in sea surface temperature in the tropical Pacific, mainly in the eastern part. So you see here the anomaly in December 2015. That's about at the maximum of the last really big El Niño. And really the temperature is say up to 4 degrees warmer from Florida to Hawaii, even further that. So it's quite an anomaly and has, you know, a lot of effects on climate worldwide. So it has a lot of teleconnections where there's big weather anomalies, particularly in the around the Pacific Basin, but even further on the globe. So I always say that, you know, El Niño is a nice project for PhD students because every 4 years you you get, you know, one. And you see here the sort of scalar measure of El Niño, where you look at, in this case, the Niño 3 box. So there's the red box on the left diagram. Can you see my mouse, by the way, Claire, or not? Okay. Not, I think. So, so you see in the say top figure, you see these El Niño 3 anomalies. So that's the temperature anomaly over the box. And you see the big El Niño in 1982-83 and 1997 and 2015. You see also that there's cooler periods, which we call La Niña. And you see it's quite irregular, but if you make a spectrum based on 100-year time series, then you see the red curve below, that it's quite a broad spectrum, but there's, you know, the peak is near 4 years. And the blue one is basically the red noise spectrum, 95% confidence. And so this indicates that this is, you know, something else than just an ocean, passive ocean, which is forced by atmospheric noise. So there really is something dynamical going on explaining this variability. Now, to give you a bit of an, just to see how the patterns and that there's also some overall correspondence between these big events. Here's the sea surface temperature anomaly left of 1997 and to the right in 2015. So you see it starts in summer, even earlier, sometimes in spring, and then you see it developing. And then the maximum of, say, sea surface temperature anomalies, It somehow arises near the end of the year, so in December. That's of course why it has its name, right, after Christ Child. And then you see it in February next year. It damps out and it goes over usually into a La Niña, where you have cooler anomalies in the Eastern Pacific. So here we are in June, June 2016 and 1998. So it has a definite pattern also. And you see also that there's quite some correspondence between equatorial patterns over the different events. Now, there are differences in El Niños, and there are actually two types, but that basically, you know, is quite a, also you can talk about a canonical El Niño when you talk about big ones. Now, the nice thing is that we know this mechanism very well, and that's not only from observation, but also from a lot of modeling studies. It here's a sketch which is in the Timmerman et al. Paper in 2018, very nicely summarized. It basically is an ocean atmosphere coupled phenomenon, where basically the, if you look at this panel C, the onset, where temperature anomalies at the surface are being amplified by feedbacks, and the three feedbacks, we call them Bjerknes feedbacks. So they give rise to wind anomalies. The wind anomalies, they change the ocean structure, so the surface between cold and warm water, which is called the thermocline, and also change the upwelling. And that's why these warm anomalies can grow through those feedbacks. And then there's wave propagation, which you see also here, that you can view it as wave propagation, also view it as the sort of the heat content changes, where eventually there's a negative feedback through the wave dynamics, which eventually restores the warm anomaly to a cooler anomaly. And then you get back into the cold phase, which is then La Niña, where you have also these feedbacks. And then you go into in the same way, you go eventually into the El Niño. Now, it's not important, you know, I'm not trying to explain you this mechanism. I just sketch you what are important components. And one is, you see here already what happens in the Western Pacific in terms of the heat content. You see it during El Niño, you see it basically, the heat content becomes negative. So the temperatures become less than average. And during La Niña, you see that it sort of becomes positive. We call this the recharge of the heat content, and this the discharge of the heat content. So during El Niño, you have a discharge. During La Niña, you have a recharge. And this is an important quantity which you think is important. The other important is that you have wind anomalies, which are also involved in amplifying these temperature anomalies. So those are important features, and we know how this system, broadly, in broad sense, we know how it works, at least the basics. That doesn't mean we can predict it very well, but at least we have an idea on what quantities are important. So this is then also a observation-based, you know, view on the probability density function. So here you see this thermocline depth anomaly in the west plotted versus Niño 3, and you see all those, say, different observations here sketching. You see it very noisy with some big, say, excursions here due to these big events. And so this is the context in which you basically have to see the prediction, say, efforts. So you see also here the AEP El Niño and the CP El Niño, those are these two different types, and it's not important, I think, for what I'm gonna tell. But yeah, they have a slightly different, you know, spatial structure in terms of the SST anomalies, and also slightly different mechanisms. Now, what is this prediction effort? Well, you can view online, you know, there's several, say, efforts, but one is the IRI CPC effort, where you see a bundle of models, all in the left picture, you see all these names, where you have dynamical models. So those are based on an equation of motion. And then you see statistical models. So those are, you know, just based on not on dynamical equations. Then what is done, you have an observations here until May, for instance. And then basically what you do is you try to predict with a certain lead time. You try to predict what is called the ONI, so the Ocean Niño Index, which is the three-month average of the Niño 3.4. So that's a slightly different box. It's centered more in the middle part of the Pacific, which you see it here in the right picture, you see this Niño 3.4. And that is because also, you know, this pattern of this, say, Central Pacific El Niños has a bit more expression into the Central Pacific. So that's why this index is usually taken as Niño 3.4. So there's a model ensemble prediction, that's the IRI CPC. And then there's also the NOAA has also at NSEP the CFS forecast, which is basically an ensemble model. So that's one model where there's an ensemble run, just as you do for the weather prediction. And also there, the aim is to predict, you know, El Niño, say, for quite a long lead time. And here you see the performance of this model ensemble to the left for 2015, starting in June. So May is then the last observation, and lead zero is the first season, so June, July, August. And you see they actually underestimated most of the models, the Niño 3.4 anomaly or the ONI, and some were really bad also, you know, basically didn't predict an El Niño at all. So in 1997, there was also a contest on prediction of El Niño, and many models failed when initialized in February. And then later, when they were initialized somewhere in June or July, they did fine. So you see already, and I showed that later also, that there's a particular, very much difference in where you say start from the prediction. So what's your initial month? Now that is shown here. There was a study that's already in 2012, where this skill of the models was evaluated. And here again, into right, you see a lot of different models. Those are mixtures of dynamical models, so the upper part, and then the statistical models. And what is the measure is usually a correlation scale. So just, you know, weighted piece of correlation between model and observations. In this case, over all seasons. And you see that skill, you know, rapidly decreases. And so when the sort of predictability horizon is believed to be 6 months. And that basically is due to, say, what we call this spring predictability barrier, that if you, say, initialize the prediction sort of in spring, so Boyle spring, then your models basically don't perform well. And when it's sort of after June, they perform quite well. And this also has to do, of course, with that the maximum is at, say, in December. So there's some phase synchronization also in the El Niño, which we understand also reasonably well for models. So this is referred to as the spring predictability barrier. And it gives an obstacle for predicting El Niño for long lead times. And 6 months is nice, but for really practical, say, advice in terms of to farmers on what to sow or on adaptation and at other regions, then, you know, 6 months is rather short. And so you want to basically sort of have a better skill for a long lead time.
Hank, quick clarification of the figure, because at least in the AI community, I'm not sure if we know about that y-axis. Can you explain how variability?
See that just as, you know, a correlation scale also, and then you just look at, you know, how much of the percentage of that variability is explained. So look at it as a correlation scale, which is very low when you start in February, March, and then it's better when you are in later.
So how is explained defined?
Let's see how this is not my picture, of course. Well, I guess 100% explains me, you know, that you really up to the, that you explain the Niño 3.4 exactly, and zero is that it's totally uncorrelated, and the percentage you can, I don't know how it's defined in this picture. This was just a story. Yeah.
Someone here said it should be viewed as R squared.
Yeah, that could also be, yeah. Okay, so machine learning efforts were actually, you know, pretty early in El Niño. This is already a paper in 1997, and actually earlier papers already in the early 90s. Where people started, particularly this group at University of British Columbia, where they already worked with neural nets to basically try to predict Niño 3.4. And here's a picture from, say, the Tangang et al. Paper in 1997, where they use as attributes the ONI itself, and then also principal components of Winster's anomalies. And they actually get, you know, even for 9 months lead time, the left picture, and for the 12-month lead time, they get basically quite a good score here for, you know, the for the El Niño prediction. So that looked very positive. But when they were evaluated in the Barnsman et al., so this is in 2012, they are actually in this whole ensemble. You see them here, the UBC NNet. Actually, they did pretty bad. You see, they, particularly for longer lead times, you know, they're sort of one of the worst models when evaluated here with this correlation scale. So what can be improved, and this is where we searched for also, is to basically look for, you know, better, say, attributes, which you can use in this machine learning approach. And of course, the people at UBC, I mean, they tried a lot of other things too. They looked at very different attributes to try to improve that. But what we focused on was basically on, that is also network, but it's complex network measures. Now, how do you derive those? Well, you can do it in many ways, but basically what the aim is to relate a sort of continuous system to a discrete system. And what you do here is, for instance, you can make what is called an interaction network. So you take two locations on the globe. You look at the temperature time series I and J, and then at node I and J. And what you do then, you get the time series, you correlate them, and you have a measure of correlation. It could be, you know, Pearson correlation or mutual information. And then what you do, you set a threshold, which you can base on statistical significance. And then what you do, you say, well, if the sort of measure is higher than my threshold, then basically I say that the two points are connected, the two locations. And so you build a graph with an adjacency matrix. And so the whole correlation analysis on, say, this different field, or you can even take different fields, boils down to analysis of the topology of the graph. And this has been quite an effort which is still going on. And I wrote a book on this a few years ago with people, other authors. And so if you're interested, you know, might be a good start. It's already a bit outdated, but because it's up to 2018. But it's basically applying this complex network, so the sort of graph theory to climate applications. Now, one of the things which becomes important later also is that you can try to follow these network measures. You can see whether they can act as precursors for El Nino, and whether you can use them eventually also in this as attributes in the machine learning approach. Now, one of the things which turns out to be important is a sort of percolation measure in the network, in this complex network. And here it's indicated by C2, which is basically the proportion of nodes belonging to clusters of size 2. And then you take a specific field, which is the thermocline network. So that basically is this network, this field, which is, say, a buildup of the boundary between the warm and cold water. And when you see C2, so that is here the red curve from observations, you can see that, you know, particularly here in 1997, so black is Niño 3.4, that it peaks quite a long time before, sort of a year before actually you get the El Niño. So this is something which you might use for long lead times in terms of prediction. And then the other measure is the warm water volume, which has been used also traditionally in regression studies, which is basically measuring this volume of water above the 20 degree isotherm. So that basically when the isotherm is very deep, so then you have, you know, that volume is large and vice versa. And also here you see that that's particularly also peaking before El Niño. And basically you can use that also as a precursor. So those are the measures which are based on. So the warm water volume is directly related to the, say, the physical picture of El Niño, but the C2 is also related to that, because when you get, say, El Niño, you basically build up a lot of spatial correlations between, say, different points in the tropical Pacific. And that eventually shows up. C2 is a sort of first indicator that that's going to build up. Later on, you get a lot more connections in the network. And then, you know, you have other measures which could show that. But this is one of the first. And so that is nice to know to use for in a prediction scheme. Now, the first attempt you can do then is basically use a more or less hybrid model, where you try to predict Niño 3.4 as a sum of, you know, a linear model. In this case, you can use a very classical ARIMA model. And then you try to model the residue from that. You try to model that by a neural network. So this is what we tried as a first step. And when you do that, and these are relatively small neural networks. So these are, you know, 4 by 3 by 1. So that is just three layers with a very small number of neurons. You see that for, say, 3 months. So here, this hybrid model is the blue curve. The observations are the black ones, and the for comparison, the CFS. So that is the operational NOAA prediction is in the red. You see that for 3 months, you know, you're just as good as sometimes even a bit worse than the if you do the overall measure, you're a little bit better than the, say, CFS ensemble. But if you have, say, 12 months, the CFS doesn't even have a prediction, and then the skill of this hybrid model is not bad. So you see that with this type of hybrid approach, you can actually, for longer lead times, you can perform better, you can have a better skill. Now, that's one step. And what we wanted after that was also have a measure of the, say, uncertainty in this prediction. And that was also already mentioned this morning, where you basically, you have output nodes which measure also, so part of the distribution, not only the mean. Now here I'm going to show the results on the what we call the Gaussian density network. So you have only the mean and the standard deviation, where you basically assume that eventually the probability distribution is Gaussian. In the paper, which you can also later, maybe if you're interested, read. I mean, we have also variant on that, where you have this quantile regression networks, where you basically have more output nodes, which basically measure the quantiles. And so you get, you can also allow for, you know, non-Gaussian distributions. Now we kept it very simple, because we also want a scheme which is rather computational efficient. And so we had one hidden layer only here with only 32 neurons. And then these attributes were really very based on the physics chosen. So we have the ONI itself. We have the warm water volume. We have the, in this case, the Indian Ocean Dipole, which is a measure of temperature anomalies in the Indian Ocean, which is also thought to be important precursor for El Nino events. Then we have a measure on the network, which is also here related. This is a Hamming distance, but it basically is related to, you know, this percolation transitions. And then we have a wind anomaly, which is basically related to this noise over the Western Pacific, which we think is very important also in initiating El Nino. And then we have the seasonal cycle. Now, in this case, you take the actual values and 3 and 6 months before. And so you have basically only 18, say, variables, 18 attributes, which you feed into, say, this neural network. Now, what we do is we do also an ensemble training. So we divide it up into six periods, so decadal periods. And then we pick one on a test. So there could be any of those periods, and then sort of ensemble train the network based on the other periods, where, say, you exclude one, which is a validation set, and the rest is used for training. And so you get, basically you get an ensemble training of the network, and where each of these periods will serve as a test case separately. Now, what comes out is that you get, for, say, a 9 months lead time. So again, this is the ONI here. You have a 9 months lead time, and then you have here this this time period here from 1960 to 2014. You see that the observations is the black one here, and then you see the mean here is the thick blue curve, And the sort of ranges here are given by, say, the 16 to 84% and the 97.5%. And so you see that 94.4% of the data fall within this larger range, and then the 69.1% with the smaller range. Now, this is not telling you much directly. You have to look at the correlation scale to compare also with other studies. And here you see it for different periods. So the black curve is for the total period, but the others are for, say, different periods. And you see also that correlation scale here is higher for some, say, periods, and particularly the also the 1992-2001, where also the UBC networks were originally applied, the skill score is pretty high. So that's the brown one. But in other areas of the red one, which is particularly the evaluation period, which was used in the Barnston, you see that the skill is relatively low also in this, say, approach. And that means that indeed the background Pacific state, at least that indicates this, is basically has sometimes, you know, prediction is easier than in other, say, decadal periods. Now, we know that there is decadal variability on the NEO, so that basically is not very strange. But here you see it directly also in these results. Now, to compare with Hamethal, which was also mentioned by Abigail, so they use this convolutional neural network approach. They use, you know, orders of magnitude more data, because they use sea surface temperature and heat content. And they pre-train also with reanalysis data and with also with CMAP5 model data. They have 21 models where they use also the data of. So that is quite a calculation to actually say get you the sort of prediction. But their result is shown here in the left figure. So here the syntax F, so the other ones are just predictions from dynamical models. Again, the correlation scale here. And this is over the period 1984-2017, so a relatively modern period. And then you see that their correlation scale goes to 0.5 at about 17 months. So that's quite an accomplishment to have such a high skill. If we apply our sort of more physics-based attributes model, which is much quicker, much easier to implement also, we see that we get a correlation scale, you know, a little less, but in the same range. So also we have quite a good skill for, you know, long lead times. And this is so a very relatively simple scheme to accomplish this. Okay, to finalize, because I'm nearly through my time also, some references. So this is, you know, a few papers on the development. We also have the software online. So there's one thing which is called Climate Learn. This is the hybrid model approach. And then we have Niño Learn, which is this, say, Gaussian density network approach, and also includes this quantile regression neural network. It's also, I think, interesting for teaching because it's relatively quick. And it's a really nicely practical problem, so it might be useful for some of you. To sort of finish off, there are a few papers on this CNN approach. So that's what the people from South Korea, Hamid, all the group follows. This is the reference of this 2019 paper. It's quite an impressive paper. Because, you know, it really is an enormous sort of skill enhancement over long lead times. And actually there's an improvement here where they basically incorporate better the seasonality and the climate data in a recent paper also by the same group. Then there are, of course, other approaches, LSTMs, also temporal convolutional networks, which are also recent. And so they are also interesting maybe to look at if you're interested in prediction of El Niño using machine learning. What we are heading to is, and that was the original motivation also, We want to understand where this skill comes from, and particularly looking at the physics of the problem. In the Hamet al paper, they do a effort looking at heat maps with the convolutional neural network approach. It looks interesting, but it's difficult, and that's for them also difficult, to build really a story, an interpretation story, which is compatible with what we know from the El Niño mechanisms. And they particularly have a larger role for instance, phenomena which are outside the Pacific Basin, which seem a bit strange that that will give the higher skill, but it's not clear. And what we want to do is a bit different approach. We want to work with what we call distorted physics simulations. And we'll start it with an easy model, which is a TBNK model, which was used basically to understand El Niño. It's a very well known and much used model. And it's also in the prediction at IRI. It's also one of the models still implemented, still giving the predictions. So what we try to do is basically we do a simulation where we sort of change the speed of the equatorial waves or modify the strength of the ocean atmosphere feedbacks. And then what we'll do is train the, say, this relatively simple, scheme what we have, the Gaussian density neural network. We'll train it with the wrong data and then basically see what is picked up from the machine in terms of the wrong physics of the system. That's a slightly different way to do it. But I hope also maybe when I come to Santa Barbara, if some of you are interested to discuss maybe also other ways on how to tackle this problem, because this is something somehow, these deep learning methods, it implies that they don't have this predictability barrier. And from the physics, we know why it happens, because in the summer, so the northern summer, the dynamical system is more prone to perturbations. So we know that actually, basically the Lyapunov exponent is larger. And so you know that there will be divergence of trajectories, and this has been shown very well also in the TBNK model. So it's very interesting how those deep learning methods can somehow circumvent that and at least give a high skill at long lead times. So any of you having ideas on that, most welcome. And I'll stop here and happy to take, questions.
Thank you. So I see a lot of clapping on Zoom. Are there any questions on Zoom? Cool. Yeah. So I'll initialize with some questions. First off, we also have noticed with both CNN, temporal CNN with attention and transformers, skill at sub-seasonal forecasting from meteorological data to solar irradiance, which is a time frame that NWP doesn't even forecast. So that is an interesting mystery. I had a question about your slide that to an ML person would look like cross-validation, but you called that ensemble training. So is the idea not that you used that data partition to tune hyperparameters, but that you actually kept each of the models from the different, what we call folds of cross-validation?
This is a bit language.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you train a model, and then what do you do with those three models?
Okay. Well, basically, you generate an ensemble, right? Which is of those different cases. So you switch. I don't see how you formulate that in cross validation.
So for cross validation, the testing would be done on a holdout labeled validation set, that you would call test in, oh, sorry, the validation set is in yellow. So if there's a hyperparameter, like usually that's the trade-off between how much you want to penalize a model for being complex, which we call regularization, versus the empirical prediction loss on your training data. You would want to tune that hyperparameter, and typically you would do it exactly in this way. You would look to see what value of the parameter would minimize the average validation error over all your three folds of the data, we call it. So here you just train them and then use them all to predict.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, that's interesting. I guess for that, we would call that bagging. And then what was the reference period for computing the anomalies? Because that is going to affect which of those ensemble members performs better, actually. I mean, it shouldn't, but we see that it does.
Mm-hmm.
So you had the temperature anomaly time series or some kind of time series where you had already computed seasonal anomalies.
I was just checking if that
overlapped with any of the members training and if then you observed better performance.
Okay, well, you know, maybe we should talk about these details when we're in Santa Barbara. That may be easier. Yeah.
Cool, that'd be great. So we have now lines of people ready to talk to you. Do you want to go ahead?
I don't hear it.
Hi, Ken. This is Dmitry Kondrashov from UCLA. Thanks very much for the great talk. So I just have a comment and a question. So I can't resist like not to brag that I'm submitting my statistical model to that multimodal AnsorPlume forecast. And in that evaluation that you talked about, my model came up like almost at the top, only maybe beaten by a few dynamical models, by a couple.
Mm-hmm.
So it's UCLA/TCD. And my question is, so are you going to submit your focus to this plume? And yes, thank you.
Yeah, but we talked to, you know, Barnston also, and they're not adding anything to the plume anymore, unless it's, you know, exceptionally good quality.
Well, it seems like you have a good claim to make. And as far as I know, Tony Barnston has retired and somebody else.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks again.
Yeah. Thank you. See you in Santa Barbara, hopefully.
Go ahead.
Okay. Hi, Hank. This is Pedram. Great presentation. So in the slide that you showed your ACC, it seems that the ACC starts declining for a few months, from like 6 months, and that leads to the good performance that you get. So is there a physical reason?
Yeah.
Or maybe even
you mean this one?
Yeah. So in like 7 months to 13, 14 months, is there a physical reason for that? The one from the other paper seems to monotonically decline.
Yeah, you mean in the Hump paper? Yeah. Well, yeah, it also sees a bit of a, difficult to answer, you know. I mean, it looks like that in the attributes and also the machine, you have a better, you know, on the long lead time, you have a better predictor. This is how I would interpret it, but I'm not sure whether that, you know, is correct. But why it plateaus, have no clue about this.
More comments, questions? Duncan, are you on the Zoom?
Yeah, I'm here.
Ah, okay. I was going to have Jakob email you. So any other discussions for Hank? It sounds like he will be coming, and we'll get to go into detail at the whiteboard when you get here.
Sorry, one more.
Oh, there is one more.
Yeah, hi Hank, thanks for the nice talk. Do you know of the forecast by the Ludesha group on the onset, where they also have a very long lead time? It's very similar, right? But they are not about the strength, like, but about the onset, and seem to achieve a, like, that gives them better skill.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, basically this network measure was, of course, motivated by their early results, right? They use a different interaction network. They look at lag correlations, and then they compute a sort of average link strength, where they show that this average link strength goes through a threshold, and they determine that by training. And then they have indeed, you know, a sort of onset of 1 year they can predict. And they did actually pretty well in predicting the 2014-2015 El Nino. So yeah, these network measures, they measure some kind of sort of integral correlation, right, of the system, and that apparently is a good, say, precursor.
All right, let's thank Hank and see you in Santa Barbara.
Yeah.